All right, so to continue on attributes, today we're going to talk about product identifiers. In the last 5 years, especially around 2016, there was a big push towards requiring product identifiers, especially the global ones like UPCs, because based on the success with Amazon, it allows products to show competitors on a unified product listing. And so we're going to go over the different types of product identifiers here. The first one would be the one that's most common or most identifiable by the seller because they typically create their own identifier for their own catalog. It's often called SKU, which stands for stock keeping unit. Sometimes it's called simply a unique ID or a product ID or just simply ID. Google in their feed spec calls it just ID. This merchant defined SKU, sometimes it can come from their vendor. So maybe they're not the ones creating these SKUs. Maybe they're just using the SKUs from the vendor list of products that they're reselling, that they're retailing. But a lot of times they create a SKU that is an abbreviation of meaningful attributes of the product so that they can identify that product across their catalog without having to look at the product name. But a lot of times the SKU could be randomly assigned, whatever it is. But the main point of a SKU would be that it's unique. Here we have a list of some common rules from Google, and a lot of these are similar with other channels, but sometimes it's specific to the channel. For Google, they want you to use a unique ID for each product because they're going to be tracking the performance of that item, that product, based on that SKU that you give them. So it must be unique across your catalog. If you provide a SKU that's a duplicate and you have two different products with the same SKU, well, how are you going to track performance uniquely across those SKUs if those IDs are not unique? They also say it should be the same across countries and languages because just for tracking performance, you want to know how that t-shirt's doing, not just here, but also in other countries. You shouldn't have a unique SKU for every region. That product in your catalog should have a SKU unique to your catalog. They don't want you to reuse it because of tracking. You know, if you're going to have performance connected to a SKU, but you discontinue that product, you don't want to reuse that SKU for a new product because now that history and performance data is tied to an old archive SKU. So you want to always make them unique across time and across your catalog. And then there's some formatting items like the SKU shouldn't be very long. It should be something like less than 50 characters. And they recommend avoiding white space. But often you'll see SKUs that have hyphens to segment different parts of the SKU, or it's just a string of letters and numbers. Then we come to something that is more defined beyond the seller, but it's not global yet. It's something that the manufacturer assigns called manufacturer part numbers or MPNs. Now, the MPN is a static identifier of a product which is universal to all distributors, wholesalers, and resellers that a manufacturer has products. So then they have these third parties or partners, these wholesalers, resellers, that are selling their products. But that MPN links that product across sellers. So it's not just unique to one seller, it's unique across sellers. So when you have an electronic item, it would have an MPN, and you could search for that MPN if you need to replace that product, like if it broke. So a lot of times MPNs are important because depending on the product type, customers are using that attribute to search for a given product. The last thing to know with MPN, especially with Google, if you submit MPN but you don't have other identifiers like UPCs, if you submit your brand, then they can use the combined brand and the MPN to identify that product uniquely in the market. So in case you don't have a barcode on your product, if you submit a brand value and you have an MPN that was legitimately assigned by that manufacturer, then they can track that product across sellers and do certain things like add content to the listing and make it easier for customers to find the product, et cetera. So beyond manufacturers and sellers, then we get into the global identifier world. This we're very used to seeing on products, which is just the barcode. That's what gets scanned at the point of sale at the store. And that barcode represents a string of numbers. And if you've ever wondered, like, where do these barcodes come from? You have to know that this number is unique across the world, maybe often just a region. So maybe it's just North America or the UK or EU versus just Japan or whatever. But these barcodes have standardized practices and rules, and they are often managed by the GS1. This is the company that catalogs, indexes, creates, manages barcodes, whether they're UPCs, EANs, ISBNs, whether they're a barcode that goes on a pallet, a box, a case. UPCs are the ones we're most familiar with. But GS1, as a governing body, they manage other GTINs, such as EAN, JAN, et cetera. They also have other global identification numbers for other things than just items. It's very important to understand that when we have conversations about GTINs, that we're talking about the umbrella term that is used to refer to UPCs, EANs, et cetera. So whenever you see GTIN, it's talking about the generic acronym that is talking about specific numbers that are in different formats. And UPCs, as you can see here on the screen, will often be 12 numbers long versus EANs, which can differ between 13 and 8 in length. And then there's GTIN 14. So when we look at requirements and feed specs, and Google talks about GTINs have to be a certain length, they'll say the length will be, you know, 8 to 14 characters long. Well, each length refers to a specific type of GTIN. And then each GTIN can have a common name like UPC, EAN, et cetera. And then when you get to the marketplaces, there's those requirements and each product needs to have a UPC, et cetera. But then the marketplaces themselves will have their own identifiers. Amazon has their own ASINs, Amazon Standardized Identification Number. And then Walmart has their own WPID. Marketplaces themselves are giving unique identifiers to items in their catalog, whether it's third-party sellers or their own items.